we are absolutely crying out for more, and I specifically say it this way, open, comprehensive secondary places.
Yeah.
And obviously, Compton have been looking for a site for a potential high school for some time.
Yeah.
If Compton don't come to Mill Hill,
yes.
What other options do we as a community have to be able to sort of open up more secondary places?
The answer is we have limited options now, in that the council does not have the funding anymore to open a new school.
So the options you have are preschool, isn't it?
Yeah. So that is why the controversial school in Underhill in Barnet is going ahead, effectively. It's not through the council's choice, it is simply that the educational funding agency bought the land from the former football club owner. Mm. And so the school will go in there. The idea was to, and then that's not a new school, we have the Saracens new school coming along.
Very welcome.
It is indeed, and not everyone, I can give you fresh news. All councillors last night voted to give Saracens the freedom of the borough. Everyone's been very impressed by what they've done. A, bringing a decrepit ground back into use, not just for themselves but for other people, and the enormous range of their charitable and social activities that they've done. And creating a new school is really a great thing for us. But yes, I agree. We seem to be able to produce faith schools and specialist schools in any numbers, but we do seem to lack the generic schools
I think
that we do need.
I feel like Archer Academy, if you finish it, I think it can prove to be a good model.
Yes.
And would be ideal for us. Do you have any view at the moment whether Compton will come to Mill Hill or what has happened decided at this stage?
I don't think it's been decided, but I hope it does.
Yeah.
I hope it does.
So that was the less difficult one.
Okay, let's have the difficult one, Richard.
All right. So Richard, you know that Pentavia is a hot issue
globally
here. There has been no bad and done here. We're well aware of the kind of the feelings locally about potential high-rise buildings, etc. And from what you said in the presentation, there's been pressure on the council to provide additional new homes. Obviously, it's somewhat sweetened by the new home bonus that the council
for
gets.
For the moment.
But the problem with Pentavia is that there was a fairly busy retail park there.
Yeah.
The leases came to an end and the stores had to close. But I think talking to a lot of people locally, they still wish to see retail on that site, and certainly I don't think anybody here wants high rise.
No.
There is, as you know, and maybe everybody else should know, is that there is a design brief out there for Pentavia. Will the council be enforcing the design brief with the developers? And can we see a maximisation of retail to get rid of any potential
Obviously, I can't bind any planning committee, and this is a personal opinion, but I think that was too high. What's not widely known is it's the same developer who owns Barnet House in Whetstone as well. And that application, the mayor has intervened in that one, which will make it actually more difficult and a denser development. Pressure is all on numbers, and that's something we need to watch. It's watch this space. We'll do the best we can, Richard.
Okay. And I'm going to be really cheeky. I'm going to ask you a third question, as I promised on the board. And this is to do with council tax.
Yeah.
The council are consulting at the moment on the £6 million funding.
Yeah.
One of your challenges, as I see it, is that you have a retail price index in place, which caps a Cambridge education degree every year.
Yes.
Yet we've frozen in the past and indeed decreased the council tax apart from the elections.
I'm afraid we can't do that this time.
No. So are you still thinking that, I mean, we've increased the council tax, you're only restricted to 1.99% increase.
But we can also bring in a 3% social care precept. Now the 3% social care precept we are thinking of bringing in simply because there is this funding. There is a funding. We're spending more on more people and we need to spend it. It's not money one can actually say, we're not going to do this. You know, this people's lives depend on it. So we will probably be implementing that.
Council tax is causing more problems than it's solved.
I don't know. I mean, you know, it's all well and good to say that, but council tax is not a sensible way of funding local authority activities. It's a perverse tax in many ways. One of the things we tend to find because of the increase in values of properties, people are extremely rich in asset terms, but cash poor, and the money they spend on council tax is something that it is very hard to avoid. It has, as I go round, an increase in council tax has a big impact on poor families, and I think one needs to be very careful about it.
But it might reach more high-rise developments if you use a plug coming back.
No, it won't affect that. The demand for housing is led by the government and the mayor saying it's needed. I think Barnet, we need to generate about 1,200 homes a year to meet the demand that we create by having children. But it's if we're being asked to produce 3,500 homes a year, that's just too much. Sorry, who's next, sir?
I'm Richard. Thanks for asking so long this evening.
No, I like it.
So if I shout, tell me I'm shouting.
If you shout, I'll be grateful.
I won't remember. My little story is we were really about to be making savings in the council in the other board. And Paul and I have been living in the hill for over 30 years. And we appreciate if we've been able to make savings in the borough council's outgoings. But why then are the council supporting a scheme to make our local railway station set free at a cost of £12 million when a group of local people suggested the idea of doing this 2 years ago? We were running a committee on behalf of the Residents Association, of which we took was chairman. And we had an estimate from a recognised engineer to do the same job, or to do, make it step three, say, of £2 million. So you could save £10 million if you wish to agree with us. And the engineer is still available. They've got the quotation. We know that other organisations are around to be done to the station, but they can be done any time. And I think a lot of them are probably cosmetic. The priority is to make our station step-free for thousands of people who are elderly and disabled.
Yeah.
And people with bags, people with bicycles, people with babies.
I could give you a flip answer, but that would be dangerous. So I will take that one away and I will respond to you in writing about that. Because if we can save £10 million, I will take that savings up. If we can do it cheaply, we'll do it. But it is something that does have to be done properly, and it's not something that is entirely in the gift of the council. The railway authorities will be involved, and they are traditionally difficult to deal with. But perhaps we can correspond about that. And
our engineer assured me that he actually worked in his job with railway companies, and he assured us that it would be done properly.
Fine. If we can do it for £2 million, I'll do it. But if it costs £12 million, we'll probably still do it, because I think it's a job that needs doing. Sorry, you've got a microphone. Go ahead.
Hi, Richard. My question goes about the council tax and the consultation for the next year's budget and savings. You spent over $70 million on policy and resources.
Yes.
Which roughly 26% of your budget.
Yes.
But your savings target, you only have $1 million against policy and resources, which is like about 12% of the savings target. And yet on children, you're spending $60 million, but you have $2.7 million savings. Surely, if you can find $2.7 million savings that you spend on money on children, you can find more than $1 million of savings on policy and resources. I just think it's unfair that you spend 26% of your budget on policy and resources, but when it comes to savings, you're almost ring-fencing and protecting that.
But policy and resources covers a multitude of activities across the council. It's the sort of wash-up term for everything else, and it has been reduced substantially over the year, and it is squeaking. Whilst we can have a look at the number of officers the council employs, we employ so many fewer than we used that, there is a point beyond which you cannot go. I mean, we've come down in 20 years, John will know better than me, we've come down from 32 directors of services to about 8 now. I mean, the top level bureaucrats, there are many, many fewer of them. Now, the danger of that is that if something goes wrong, you have fewer senior eyes to look at the problem and put it right. There's a balance to be struck, but there are savings across all services. But children's, I don't think the services, we can't reduce the cost of that. I think it's a saving that is unlikely to be realised, that one.
So
children's services, we've had to put more money into this year. I forget the figure, I think it's between £5 and £6 million in the year.
So are you saying that 2.7 million savings for children will not actually happen?
It may not happen, and I suggest in your consultation, if you respond to the consultation, you suggest that.
I did respond. I actually think if you spend more money on children, less money on those directors.
Well, that's always a popular idea with most people. I have sympathy with it as well. Sorry, the ladies first. Right,
so we have a lot of development in Mill Hill, in Colindon, but there is a lack of community facilities like community centre. Mm-hmm. So what is the council plan for that? Because, I live and work in the borough. Okay, I have very good working relationship with the council, and I work with very outstanding people in the council with very kind, compassionate hearts. However, as a resident, I also get really frustrated. For example, because I run a food bank, I run a debt centre over at Avion Crescent,
yeah.
And that's become a meet-up point for lots of vulnerable people. Like the elderly, where we have to get involved, to get social services involved, otherwise nobody will be aware of her situation. And then we have people with increasing number of people with no recourse to public funds coming towards us. And we also see very vulnerable children that need to be safeguarded, and we have challenges for that. So as a result of what we are doing in the community, our centre become a local place where people just gather. And at this present moment, in a lot of consultation, we have yet to see what's the council plan for a community centre or anything per se.
There will be a community centre in Grand Park when that's finished. There are community facilities going in there. And I visited what you do in Adrian Crescent, and it will be a grave loss to the borough if that stops. So we do need to find you somewhere to go, and we will do that.
I mean, ideally we'd like to be where we are, because people have associated us with a place where they are safe, because that's an association of safety, association of being not being judged, in that sense. So hopefully that could be looked into, because my volunteer, with your funding cut, you're depending a lot more on the third sector like ourselves to get involved. And we are actually stretched, really stretched as well.
No, I know, but what we've done at Stonegrove has been very successful. Have you seen the community centre there? Mm-hmm. That facility is absolutely great. And when the Church of England Diocesan Property Board came to see me, this is usually the cue for great nerves. What on earth do they want? But they came up with a really good idea, and they've got a very small church there, and they merged the community facility that the council was going to create there with the one that the church was going to create there. And ended up with a much more useful place, actually, which can be used by the church on Sunday and by the community the rest of the week. It can be done.
Yeah,
it can be done.
Like that. And then also the other thing is that as a resident where I live, we have parking issues. Okay, I know everywhere has parking issues, but we start to see heavy vehicle actually park on pavements. And young and families with moms with prams have to come and walk on the road, which is quite dangerous.
Let us know.
Yeah.
We'll send the wardens around.
Right. I called the council. The council asked me to call the police. Mm-hmm. I called the police. The police called me to call the highway. And
well, I'm reluctant to say call me, but which ward do you live in?
Colindale.
If you don't get a response from the local councillors, then call me. And we will send the parking wardens round. Because it's an easy source of revenue for the council If someone's parked on the pavement, particularly if it's a truck, they need to be ticketed and sorted out. Roger.
Richard, as you probably know or may not know, I'm the chair of the Archangel Trust, which is responsible for raising funds for St. Michael's School in North Finchley. I think you'll agree with the best schools in the country, but they're
usually in the top three.
And the league table to back that up. You're probably also aware that the headmaster who retired in July went public with some issues about funding schools, specifically grammar schools.
Yeah.
London schools face a massive funding crisis. It's not just St. Michael's, it's all of them, it's across the board.
Yes.
For people who don't know it, the government awarded teachers a pay increase this year, but they didn't actually increase the funding for schools. And so teachers are getting paid more, which is a good thing, and I think we can all agree with that. But the schools have had to find the money out of their own budgets. Now, on top of that, there's a new funding formula coming in that's going to discriminate against London schools. Barnet, under Richard's leadership, has got a very good record with schools. But the truth of the matter is that the funding issues threaten that.
Yes.
Now, I attended a meeting of the Cells Committee last month, and I was a little bit perturbed that the chair of the committee chose not to respond to the question and say he would lobby the Secretary of State of Education for a better deal for London schools, because it's a London-wide problem, I'm sure you'd agree. What exactly are you as leader and your council going to do to ensure that we don't see a negative effect, the fantastic service that you've built up?
Well, I haven't given up on getting the money. I haven't given up yet. So there are two ways to approach this kind of thing. If you approach it in and you go and see the minister and you explain, you know, we need this money, blah, 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 and you talk about it quietly, you can often be more successful than creating a great big public furore. And we're certainly in contact with the minister at the moment. And I hope that we will get her to blink. But, you know, that. I don't want to go. It's an extraordinary funding system that we have, and you know, and the concern. There is a lot of controversy about the funding formula as it works against Barnet, and this is schools, the police, the health service, and the council. The Treasury has the same model for each, and it discriminates against London, and it particularly discriminates against outer London boroughs like Barnet, Harrow, and Enfield. So whatever the party appellation, you tend to find there is agreement between the outer London boroughs in trying to sort this out. Now we have a commitment that it will be fixed by 2020. But the current system was actually introduced by Neville Chamberlain before World War II, and it is a nightmare for any government to sort out. But it does need to be fixed, as it is grotesquely unfair, the current arrangement. On the council tax side, I'm going to need a prompt for the figure. The difference in subsidy that Camden received and the one we received, I think it's £800 a household? It's £650 a household difference. So, you know, £650 off your council tax if we receive the same money as Camden. And no one can tell me that Hampstead and Belsize Park are poorer places than Barnet.
Is there any prospect for doing something via the council tax to help schools out?
I don't think that's going to be possible. I mean, the budget is already so stretched, but I haven't given up yet, Roger. It's all right. I think we're on the same page here. You know, the schools in Barnet are something that we are rightly proud of, and we wish to retain the excellent schools that we have, and if they're starved of money, they will not be as good as they are. Thank you.
Traffic as part of the school has increased, so the access in and out of the top
please, yeah. And I will try, but usually obstruction is actually a matter for the police, so.
Of course it is, the emergency has got to be clear, and fire engine will allow you to get
through. It's complex, I mean, to be honest, I think the capacity has got worse, and sometimes the arguments that you hear, and also, like, for example, it's not really during the school times, because obviously when the school in the evening, they have obviously parents and kids or whatever, and it happens in the evening time, it's really difficult. But not only that, if you want to get in and out of your drive, you almost have, I mean, I'm not an argumentative person, but I've had terrible confrontations with other people, and people feel that they're entitled to either block you in or block you out, and I have actually got a drop down curve, and I can't understand it. I have been over to the chapel, the school, and my understanding is the two schools, although they're next door to one another, they're not the same school. And I've actually had parents lock me in. I've had the other thing is as well, we know where delivery vans that are coming from the school will block me in. Again, if I'm not going in or out, I won't bat an eye, but when I actually personally want to get in and out, I'm made to feel like, seriously, I'm made to feel second class. I find it really frustrating. And then actually, back at last week, because I went to Collendale police station, I've had a terrible encounter with an individual and then seemed to think I'm not entitled to get in or get back out to my drive. So I went to Collendale Police Station and the lady at the desk said to me, if you can't get in, you phone the traffic wardens, which I do, but often they don't appear in time, you know, it's about an hour and a half later sometimes.
Sometimes tonight.
Yeah. Correct. Or if you're locked in trying to get out of your drive, phone police, which I don't like doing. About a week ago, I did phone 101, and I know they were really busy, and every hour, for about 3 hours, I phoned 101 saying, look, there's a car blocking my drive, okay? And at one point, the person on the phone said, why don't you go and run around and find out who's doing it, which is quite a point, but you get really frustrated. I did in the end go to two schools, so nothing to do with us. They kept ringing back 101, every hour, and they kept trying to, they said they left, so obviously you must have the contact details of someone's car, so I gave them a registration. When the individual came back, I went out and spoke to them, and I said, do you realise how these have took me out? Oh, my wife's in hospital, and I thought, well, what's that got to do with you blocking my driveway? So I think as well, there's no signs to say, look, don't block drop down curb. Also, the road is not built for the amount of traffic.
But the highway code makes it quite clear. You cannot park in front of a dropped curb.
That's the question. This is more directed at perhaps the police than yourself, Richard. Is there any reason why someone does that you can't just take a photograph of their car blocking the drive and their number plate and send it to the police and they can deal with it and get on to the owners? Because they can find the owner who is in there.
Absolutely fantastic idea. What we want to do though is enforcement is the answer. And yours seems quite a unique one that very much involves the school. And we've had issues like this in the past over the borough. And again, with Peter Clifford and his team, police have mediated, come up with some solutions like that, work together to resolve it. Because you're right, 101, there are some real issues getting through to police. Just as you can see, the infrastructure, more people, more vulnerable, more people wanted healthcare, police, etc. But definitely, we'll see you, take your address and find out, and we'll definitely be in touch because there's some work we can do with the school because they're equally responsible.
But your ward councillor should be in action with the school, so if you email me, I will remind them they should do that, and I will write to the school as well, so that they know they're being watched by the council as well as by the police.
Thanks for coming today.
Thank you.
I wanted to pick up on something which kind of follows on from that, and something which you've mentioned today, quite a lot of people mentioned, which is transport.
Yes.
Tara.
Yes.
And I'm going to pick up first of all the fact that you mentioned east-west.
Yes.
East-west in the borough is truly awful.
Yeah.
The amount of money that you're spending on roads, you said 50 million, even if you really need 350 million. And I just want to give a sort of example, and I should quite shy away from personal examples, but I can give a personal example here. About 8 months ago, I actually dropped my children in the toddler ward,
yes.
And I then had to go to Elstree Bournemouth afterwards.
Yes.
Right? Rush hour time, that took me an hour to an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a journey which by other modes, public transport, cycling, can be simply done in 20 minutes.
Yes.
Right. Within the within London itself, two-thirds of our journeys are made by car. There are less than 5 kilometres.
Yes.
Each of these are journeys that can be walked in about 40 minutes or cycled in about 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Yet in this borough we consistently have 60% plus of our journeys done by car.
Yeah.
Right. We have parking issues left, right, and centre. So many people today have talked about parking issues. You yourself mentioned it's a controversial idea to just close one side to clean because of the amount of cars. I think that there's two questions here. Is one, do you accept that there are just simply too many cars in Barnet? And two, why is the council not focusing on higher proportion done by public transport, done by walking, done by cycling?
Well, the answer is we are concentrating on that. I mean, you probably argue that we're not going. I think the microphone is counterproductive, actually.
Yeah.
Thank you, that's better. You are quite right, and I have to confess, I made the mistake tonight of driving from Hendon Town Hall. Now, it took me an hour to get here tonight. Now, I could easily have walked down to Hendon Central Station and come here by train, and it would be much, much quicker. But I have to tell you, I'm one of the very few councillors who regularly goes and comes from the Town Hall by bus. There is a bus route arranged for, oh, John does as well, but there's one arranged for my convenience that goes from the town hall to the end of my road. But I promise it predates my time on the council. It is very important that we do this. We have to take the public with us, and at the moment, there is little alternative to cars. Bus routes are not designed to get used. If you want to go to town, of course you go by train. Only someone very eccentric or very, very would dream of driving to central London. But for those local journeys, if you want to drive from anywhere to Totteridge, you're going to really do it by car.
I'll put it to you that study after study in London has failed to at least 8 years of their transport, the phone and service to handle those trains, have shown that people want an alternative.
Yeah.
And the only way that you can provide an alternative is to actually go along and fund safety on roads like this, find better walking environments, to actually give people a choice. Even down to the fact that if I want to go out and buy an electric car, Barnet's entire view on electric cars is to have 100 charging points within a 3-year period.
Yeah, that may be the case, but their starting point. There's also a project.
But that's been the same target for 3 years.
But there is action on that across London now. That is, there will be charging points, and the latest plan is to fit them into street lamps so that there will be extra charging points, which should accelerate the delivery. Now, I have to confess, I came up with an idea which was laughed at by the other 62 councillors, so it didn't go anywhere, which I'll float with you. As you know, on the second parking permit for a house, there is a charge based on the polluting effect of the car. Now, my argument was that we should actually charge by the length of the car, because it's easy to measure the things, and actually, what more justification could you want for parking based on the length? The longer the car, the more you pay. Mm-hmm. It seemed quite sensible to me, but I failed to persuade my colleagues of that. But we need more cycling paces.
It's not just we need more cycling paces. Every time this question has been asked of anybody in the council, the standard answer is there's no space, which is just not true. It is just simply not true.
Yeah, but when the cycling lobby comes up with ideas of shutting two lanes on the Great North Road, they're not going to get very far.
Can I make a practical suggestion?
Of course.
I think a few people have come up with previously.
Yeah.
Between Middle Broadway and Broadwalk Centre and Edgware, there's a huge railway line.
Yep.
There's long been talk of doing various things for it. Now, for me, the ideal use for it, which wouldn't cost very much money, would be to turn it into a dedicated cycle lane from Edgware to Mill Hill. And
yep.
It would make access from Deansbrook to Edgware, from Mill Hill to Edgware General Hospital, and a lot of places like that, a lot safer, and it wouldn't cost a lot.
And I'd actually go further than that, because you've also...
There's a slight glint in my eye, though. I mean, one day it'd be nice to get a railway link, wouldn't it?
Well, if you put it as a cycleway, it would preserve that so that it would be easier to do that in the future.
And then you can win that battle that you're talking about, so you can get more people out of their cars, then you can take space away, because at some point, closing two lanes on the Great North Road does make sense. Maybe not at this moment in time, but at some point when no one's using their cars,
when no one's using their cars,
it will make sense. But until you give people an option, everyone's going to use their car.
Maybe also because with the new buildings, new properties that come up, the flats, they do not come with parking space. They wanted to sell parking space to people. And as a result of that, people start to park elsewhere, like onto my street, for example. And we, the residents, don't have any parking because other, like New Hanson Village, they will end up parking on our street. So, don't you think partly is because of poor planning?
I would say the problem is not that they don't have any parking spaces. If you look,
they charge 15,000.
No, if you look at Antalya Park, which I'm holding against the entire scheme of Antalya Park, that's got double the amount of bicycle parking spaces than it does cars. The problem is no one's going to ride a bike because the streets are not safe enough.
Well, you wouldn't ride there because
it's
not too dangerous.
If you look at Singapore,
it's
a small country, but if you, we have lots of parties, cater for everybody.
If you look at the mayor's new London plan, which is out for consultation, and it's 500 riveting pages about what's going to be done to London. Well done, that's further than I've got. But in there, there is a considerable reduction in the parking that will be required for new development. As at the moment, Barnet has one of the highest parking requirements of any London borough. In fact, I think we've got the highest, but it's just not realistic to expect people to do without their cars in the outermost part of the borough. The innermost part, I think it's a reasonable request, but I think there is a need for cars still in outer
London.
So
one of those journeys that you can't do public transport, and there are people who I think they need a personal vehicle actually. Yes.
But do you actually know how many journeys are done in, you made this claim, but do you know how many journeys are done in and out of, say, High Barnet that can't be done by public transport or bus?
I don't know that figure in honesty, but that would be an interesting one to do some research on. But you know, there's a lot of the Mr. Toad attitude with some of our residents. I think people would be very reluctant to pick up their cars.
I think it's a
question of moving very gently towards that.
We're facing a crisis, and at some point you can't
avoid it.
And if you're scared of the political battle, then there are people out there who can help you win that political battle.
Can
I just make a point?
Yes.
Excuse me, is this a public meeting? Yes, it is. Why are they
turning
over the
meeting?
Let the people talk, please.
Fine. Sir, you've got the microphone.
My question is about council tax consultation again.
Yeah.
One of the items of proposed saving is about funding for schools. One of the proposals that I read said that council is considering options to require schools to contribute to their renovations and repairs.
Yeah.
So, am I understanding correctly that in the future I might have to contribute for the renovations and repairs of my children's school, which is like basic education human right?
No.
And I have to pay for it?
No, as a parent, you don't have to do that. No.
Okay. But where would the school get the money if it doesn't come from the council?
It will come from the school's budget, which will have to come from the government. The government has to pay us more money per child, has to pay the school more money per child in order. Someone from this side.
Sir? Against these grandiose schemes you've proposed, mine is quite small beer, pavements.
Yes.
In my road in particular, which is Upcroft Avenue in Edgware, the pavements are a disgusting state.
Yeah.
People have been forced to, which is hardly dangerous to walk on.
Yeah.
People have been forced to walk in the road, which is also highly dangerous. I have been in contact with my local councillor. He was, and why nothing has been done. He said, as against other areas have been done, he said, well, that's in a different ward. I failed to see what bearing that has on the matter. When this meeting was organised, I put in my observation on this, and the question was, what do you want the council to do about this? So my answer was, well, repair it, obviously.
Yes.
Now, the point is that I've heard nothing about it, nothing has been done. This has been going on for God knows how many years, and it's a highly dangerous situation.
I will get someone to come and have a look at the road, and we will try and get it done. I mean, we are gradually getting round. It's slow, but it is. There are roads in every ward that are being done.
It's been very, very slow.
It is.
It's hail.
Hail, okay. So if you could, we will get someone to come and take a look at it and see what we can do. I mean, if they are actually dangerous, they will be fixed straight away temporarily.
I was asked to give specifics.
Yeah.
I said yes. From number 24 to the end of the road.
Yeah.
Is that specific enough for you?
Okay.
I had no answer from that.
Okay. Well, we'll make sure you get an answer. Okay.
But how are pavements looked at? We don't see anybody going around looking in certain roads.
They are looked at, I promise you. There are people who go around and look at them, and residents in Barnet do tend to tell us when pavements are bad, and we're grateful for that. And there is money to do them slowly, but they do get done. They do get done. They should, and they do. They do. They do.
Not if the car is on top of the
pavement. It is illegal to park a car on the pavement, but the enforcement is patchy at that, and it does take a ward councillor to ask for enforcement of that. Because there are some roads in the borough which it is simply, it would be really difficult to actually survive if you didn't have some element of pavement parking, so it needs a slightly flexible approach.
So on my street, they park on pavement, just like two families, and pavement was used to be really good pavement, but they just like quite old.
Well, we're trying to put more robust pavements in place.
Different questions about safeguarding. Would you be
okay? Yes, go for it.
So I've seen a lot of vulnerable people,
Either
children or elderly. And I've also seen an increased number of women addicts, women who are abused by men.
Yep.
I find reporting safeguarding very difficult.
Do you?
Yeah.
I'm surprised at that.
Because nobody is interested.
No, we are interested.
Yeah. And
the council per se is interested. The police are interested and the health service is interested.
But that's not my experience, and I at one point had to go and back the social services, please look into that.
So would you please email me privately about that particular case and I'll get that looked into, because there is a multi-agency safeguarding hub which involves the police, social services, NHS and the council, and it's designed to get joined up thinking so you can actually come up with an effective solution. This kind of problem, and I'm very disappointed that you found it difficult to get in touch.
It is very challenging, and also there is
It really shouldn't be.
No, you need
to go straight to the top.
Yeah, and there's mental.
I'm reluctant to say email me, but yes, please.
So there's mental.
Please.
I will give you the pieces that I need.
Please.
So we have a report about crisis team about people suffering from mental health.
Yes.
And the only question they asked me. They said, do you think they will kill themselves? I said, I'm not sure. Yeah. Not sure you're still with them. I said, but I need to go back to work. She's not my only client. Yeah. So literally, I have to stay with that person, and the crisis team never turned up, and I have to drive this person literally to the hospital. And no one is actually interested, and after that, no one even visited.
Well, I'm disappointed that there are dedicated mental health social workers.
So we need to look into that because it is quite.
That's fine. That's good. The lady's got a microphone. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
I work on the letter we're going to say. We are all depending
Yes.
Every March this year.
Yeah.
And we'd like to have some information about how we can contact housing benefits, department, and the domestic violence department, because we have been informed that I am appointed as a domestic violence coordinator in the board at the moment. In terms of the domestic rate, we would like to have as a charity that we are have some conversations with the housing benefit. But we haven't been able to contact anybody, and nobody has been able to contact us at all.
We will find a way to do that.
Yeah, and that's why, because we are, bringing around 24 bed spaces to the board. Basically, for the BME community in the board, that is 42%, if I'm not wrong. That's what we're here, because we would like to have some information how we can contact people, because we haven't been able to.
We will take your names and email, and we will find appropriate contact for you. Yes, that's excellent. Thank you. Gentlemen, you've attended all of them. Congratulations. How you've stuck it, I don't know, but thank you.
A quickie to start off with. Apparently there's form flying around for the more secure tenants to be able to sign up to see if they've got a chance to become secure council tenants, which is mainly on the regeneration estates. Can you confirm or deny that this is actually floating around for these residents? Because there's quite a few which...
I can't at the moment, no, but I will answer that in writing.
Okay.
I'll give you a proper answer rather than guess at one.
Okay, if you do ASAP, please.
ASAP.
Thank you. Now coming to the parking. I raised about Boothwick Road.
Yes.
And there's Marsh Drive, the utilities where yes. This is coming on.
Yes. I think someone's been round there.
Yeah. Apparently Mr. Ian Dawes, who's been running a project. We've been trying to get hold of these people for over 2 years about these issues. They're not doing anything. Now, the residents who are paying for their parking permits haven't got parking space now. They haven't been given their parking anywhere else, and they haven't been reimbursed. Now, this has gone straight to the parking place as they go around and start getting tips to these people. Utilities which have actually taken up all these bays so that they can do the work, are actually paying the council for these bays as well. So now the council are getting two amounts of money coming in for the same bay. Now I think it's not very, I would put it in polite words, is that I believe that the residents should be getting alternative, should be given alternative parking, and they should be being reimbursed for the fact that their parking space has now been taken away from them. And this is happening constantly, especially on the regeneration space. This is throughout the project, which has lasted about 10 to 12 years. So these people are constantly losing their parking space.
Well, I'm not going to defend something that sounds indefensible, so I will look into that. I will look into that, because it does seem, there does seem to be, I can't prevent it.
Well, the other side of that, of course, is the fact that Mark opened up something that goes very quickly for the residents, is the fact that the people running, what they do is they give out the work, such utility works can be done.
Yeah.
Now, we've got an officer, the council officer, who's supposed to be liaison, and he does a very good job on the estate so that we know what's going on, so the residents know what's going on, but they don't suddenly come back. There's one tenant suddenly come back over the weekend and found their car had been moved. To me, that was an illegal thing to do, because the resident had no idea and hadn't been given prior notice of this. So they was most upset and had to find out what was going on, because they didn't know why their vehicle had been moved, they had actually moved it. Now, this person refuses to come and talk to us, refuses to liaise with us. We've been asking the department for over 2 years now to come and liaise with us. They're refusing to do that. Their only comment which did come back was, oh, I thought that the council officer would have been trying to get the work done ASAP, which isn't acceptable. We want this person to come and talk to us, the same as any other estate, and to make sure that they engage with us with all the works, because we know that there's going to be more works over the next 3, 4, 5 years where this is going to be interrupted and carried on doing it. So, would you give us an update on what's coming on, please? Because he's decided he's now on a holiday and won't be back to January. So,
well, he might find a nice email on his desk when he gets back.
Okay, thank you. Just on that, it's just if the policy is looked at, so all these works which goes out throughout the borough, that as far as I understand, this board which actually sit there, rather than being able to sit in their office and just be able to tell everybody, no, I'm not doing anything without it, and carry on with going.
I think you know more about utilities working in the borough than I do, and I confess that right from the start. But there are, I think you're correct me if I'm wrong, I think there are 32 agencies that can dig the roads up, aren't there?
There is, but they still need the permission from the council who can stop the work up to an hour before it actually starts.
I think it's quite, rather than permission, it's a bit closer towards inform the council.
No. Working with the utilities companies, I know with the APIs, BTDs, Wayne's, that right. They have to go through the council. And it's the council which gives the permission, it's also the council which should be notifying the residents. Again, that was a failure on the council side. It's if it wasn't the utility actually dropping the letters through the door, asking people not to ask that they would start the following week, the people wouldn't even know who was doing what.
Well, it sounds like we need to be a bit more robust there.
Thank you. I've got one more question, but I want to let someone else ask.
We'll come back, yeah. Thanks, Jack. I'll ask it just a little
bit. Please, Jack, what's that?
I believe Transport for London are responsible for the traffic flow across Apex Corner and the circuits.